Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this conversation with Radu Jude. We are gathering here in the occasion of celebrating Radu's recent triumph with his last film, Bad Luck Banging or Looney Porn, but because also there is a small retrospective of his work now playing at DAFilms that will be available for you until the 30th of April. And this is a retrospective that is very smartly called Forget About These Films. So, I wanted to first welcome Radu to this conversation and say it's very nice to meet you virtually at least, and I hope next time we'll see each other will be on site. But first, welcome Radu.
Thank you for the invitation. I'm glad to speak with you, even if it's online only and virtual.
So in the occasion of this small retrospective that is being organized here at DAFilms with you, you made this very interesting introduction video that I think if our viewers haven't seen already, they should absolutely go see it after this conversation, because it's not only very smart, but incredibly hilarious. And in this introduction video, you talk about a death threat of a sort that you received recently for one of your last films. And this death threat that you received in this poem that someone wrote about your work has in a way a suggestion of an epitaph for you. And this epitaph is the thing that that DAFilms chose to as the title of this retrospective, which is that the poet was saying that people should forget about your films. And you said, in order to forget about my films, you should watch them first. So I was thinking that this poet in a way fell into his own trap, because there is something that the poet saw about your films that is very interesting, and I think it has to do with most of your work, that is that so many of your films have to do with history and deal with history and selective oblivions in the tellings of history. And forgetting and not looking at history responsibly and things that are taken for granted sometimes. And I have the feeling that a lot of your films, many of which are playing now at DAFilms, have this sensation of being screaming in a way, you know, history is all around it, all around us. Can't you see it? And I think this is something that that you produce also with your work. That you fabricate with the elements that you bring in the films that you do, when these elements being archives, anecdotes, characters, movements that your characters do around the city or even inside an apartment. So looking at this idea that this poet had and looking at your films, and in this context, I wanted to start the conversation by asking you, why do you make films?
Well, first of all, it's really funny that we call that idiot the poet all the time. I mean, it's some imbecile with a computer, and I call him in this video, ironically, the poet, and then now you give him a real profile as a, you know, the poet is like it's Shakespeare or like somebody like that. And actually, that's small video. The Doc Alliance never told me this is going to be the title of the talk. They said, "Well, can you send us an introduction?" And I said, "Well, okay." And I will think of something. And then I said, "There are so many, somehow the films are not very different that I cannot put them together under." A concept or something like that. So then I remember this poem, which is a question of pride. Even if it's a bad poet, somebody took the pain to write some rhymes about my work and saying that. And well, it's true that then you interpret it in this very much too subtle way. Now to answer your question, this you know, there is a talk of with that physician. There is a, you can find it on the internet with Richard Feynman, and at some point the he's speaking with someone who asks him why the gravitation exists or something like that. And he's really funny. He says, you know, this why question is the worst in the world because it's the hardest in the world. Because if you ask me, you know, imagine that your mother-in-law falls on the ice and goes to the hospital and breaks her bones. And you start to asking, why did she break her bones? Well, because she fell on ice. Why did she fall on the ice? Because the ice is slippery. Why is ice slippery? Because when you put pressure on it, it melts and the molecules make it glide. Why does it melt when you when you put pressure on the ice, and so on and so forth, that you will never, never have a final answer to the why question. So that, you know, Feynman said this is the worst questions of all to ask why. But of course, I try to find an answer to that. And the thing is that it's difficult. Now I believe, now I think I have an answer now, but this answer was not all the time valid for all my professional life, so to speak. And of course, it's much messy, the desire to do something. But one of the things is that it offers a way to think and to study in a way something, to study the reality, the people, the history, and to express what you were able to find or to research. So I think it's a tool of research and of curiosity, something like that, maybe. So
hello.
This is hello. He doesn't hear because I have the headphones. Yeah.
And do you, well, it's a way to study something, but do you think by making films do you provide yourself with any answers, or it's more that you open more questions?
Well, I think here is also a kind of cliche to say, well, and all filmmakers like to repeat this ad nauseam, saying like, my film doesn't give answers, only, you know, poses questions, raises questions. And I think this is true, but it became too much a cliche, you know, because I know, I think I try to give some answers in a way, and I tried not to raise the questions only. And the answer is the film itself, so to speak. I don't know how should I say it. More like,
I was thinking about that a lot when I was watching. For this talk, I rewatch a lot of your films, not only the ones that are in the films. And I was thinking,
I'm sorry for you.
I was thinking about how your films do draw lines. I do think they, I don't know if they give answers to questions, but they do have hypotheses on histories or ideas, you know, or thesis on how history works or how things can be tied together. And there is a sense of lines that come, you know, it's like you're observing the present and then you're throwing lines to the past in order to understand why we act the way we act or why we live the way we live. Even in the case of your last film, Bad Luck Banging, there is this sensation of trying to understand why are people so rude.
Yes, but I think it's too, you put too big a thing on my shoulders, like with this generalization. I think it's the films focus on very, very specific and topics, and I know it's how should I say, it's something of the artists themselves or filmmakers in our case, or writers, whatever it is, that they seek how you would call, they seek eternal truth or general truth or human condition truth, so to speak. And for instance, when I do not care if we go down in history as barbarians, some people complained about the fact that it's too specific. Why is it about Romanian army mass murder on the Odessa in the Eastern Front? why is not about something bigger than that? Like the general nature of the human being is that we can kill each other and so on and so forth. And I think that this is a bit problematical, because focusing on something general, it's like it's something that serves the ones who don't want to talk about these specific things. You know, it's better to make a film about it's better to make a film about a general thing, general violence, not about a specific case of violence, to take this small example. And I think there is not only a passion for history, not for history, because people say, oh, you're interested in history, and I'm not interested in history the way a historian or somebody who's passionate about history is. I never watched this history documentaries on History Channel, or I never read history magazines. I never read this kind of stuff because I'm not interested in history. I'm interested in this, as you said, this relations between past and present, this feeling that not everything is closed from history. I mean, of course, the events are past, but some of the ideas, some of the things survive and are around in a way, even if it's only symbolical, so to speak. And I think I noticed that, and I finish with that. 3 years ago, we had in Romania a very shameful referendum against LGBT people. It was called the referendum for the family. I think it was also in other countries in the Eastern Europe in the last years. And it was organized by some American associations with the local politicians and our national church. And when it was in the parliament, when they decided to allow the event to happen, this anti-LGBT referendum to take place, there were speeches for that. And all of a sudden, if you would listen to those speeches carefully, you would feel like you are in the 40s or at the end of the 30s. It was really like in the fascist times of Romania, the same ideas, the same words, sometimes the same expression, the same pathos. I don't want to say it's the same thing. I think this is really, or history repeats itself, or these banal things, but in a way you would feel that. I felt like seeing a bit of the ideas from the fascist times of Romania. So that would be a film. That could be a small montage moment, taking one phrase from the 30s and one phrase from this speech. It would be the same thing.
I was going to ask you about montage, because I think one of the big operations that take place in your films, if I were to separate your films from your non-fiction work that is mostly based on archival work, and then your fiction work that is, it also has an operation of montage that usually have to do with camera movements and internal montage, whereas with your non-fiction work, there is a lot of, there's also montage between different documents. So I wanted to ask you, how do you relate to the idea of montage as synthesis, as a way of creating ideas?
Well, I think it's quite for somebody like you who knows so much about cinema history, is nothing new, and maybe nothing very good nothing at the greatest level in my films. But I feel that at least in Romania, I think this part of cinema, this branch, let's say, and not only of cinema, because I think montage, thinking about montage in this way starts, I don't know, with modernism and starts with Eisenstein, but with Walter Benjamin at the same time, and with John Dos Passos in literature, and with Joyce, and with collage in paintings, and all of these kind of things. And it's a branch that in cinema, let's say, we started with Eisenstein and went on with, I don't know, with found footage filmmakers, with Godard, with Makaveev, with this side of cinema that it's not really used that much, I think, nowadays. Although I think we live the time of montage. Even if we look now at our window, then when we are talking, it's 4 or 5 images in the same time. We can, or if you're zapping, on a television, it's happening. It's so these clashes of images, creating ideas, fake ideas, dangerous ideas sometimes, but sometimes very interesting concepts. I think it's something that needs to be explored. And I try to do that as much as I was able to. And it becomes a part of thinking, so to speak. I mentioned Eisenstein, and it's somehow ridiculous in his writing that he sees montage everywhere, in a poetry, in a painting, in film, in theater, and in one of the texts he even sees montage in the party text, the first 5-year plan of the Communist Party, and Eisenstein saw in the text a montage operation. Well, but I think I understand him, because when you start thinking of that, the problems of montage, the problems of the juxtaposition of things, of ideas, of images, of whatever, images and sounds, all of a sudden this, you start seeing it everywhere. It's like, it becomes something important, and you see it, and you start to reflect on it. But the problem is that it doesn't have solutions. It doesn't have, it's something so, how should I say, with so many meanings, so many possible meanings all the time, that maybe this is why many filmmakers refuse to use it, because you cannot have a very clear idea using montage. You have a very clear idea if you stay away from montage in this sense, in this meaning. I mean, if you see, somebody like Darden Brothers, for instance, they would try to use for their storytelling devices and for their dramaturgy, there's not a real thinking about montage in this way, I mean, because they want, I think, the signification of what they do to be extremely clear and extremely controllable by them, to be controlled. Montage makes you to be less controlled, I think, which is the nice part in the same time.
Yes, I agree. I think it is watching your films create this experience of that kind of craziness that you describe of Eisenstein, that is that you start seeing montage everywhere, and you start seeing juxtaposition even inside one same shot. So yeah. I have become lately very obsessed with your panning shots as ways of montage, because you're usually moving, you know, from one character to the city or and then you start to understand how public space, for example, you know, a city, you know, the street in a city is absolutely plagued with juxtapositions all the time, that you are ignoring when you are walking around, you're ignoring them in order to, I don't know, walk, run an errand, because in the minute you start seeing the ways you see them in your films, it's overwhelmingly, what do you call this? The senses are overwhelmed in a way by political juxtaposition of public sphere. But then you do the same inside an apartment, for example, and then you start seeing the juxtapositions in the private space.
No, yeah, I think it's true. I think it's true. And as I said, it's I think the film was somehow criticized by the Romanians who saw it by saying, "Well, you insist too much on certain details. If I walk in the city, I can see other stuff." And I say, "Well, of course, it's a point of view in the film. It's on a horizontal view." There is this joke about a Romanian science guy, Gore Moisil, who at some point says, you know, every person has a horizontal view, but in some cases, this horizontal view became so small that it's only a point of view, and that's a point of view, something very small. But no, I believe that that the film, it is not... some people say about this first part in Bad Luck Banging, about what you mentioned, saying it's a documentary. It's like an observational documentary. And I understand why they say this, but in the same time, because the camera makes these juxtapositions, I think is the opposite of a observational documentary, because in an observational documentary, the author or the director, the cameraman, whatever, they wouldn't try to make, to force connections for the audience. They would make, I don't know, a wide shot, or they would let the audience find the connections in the shot. So I think, yeah, I'm interested into that and these things.
I think this also connects to something that I've read in an interview that you were discussing with Roger Cosa once about the lack of subtlety that you sometimes have been accused of, as if this were an accusation, no? Because I think there is something in your work that has to do with this lack of subtlety, that it has to do more with straightforwardness. And the political possibilities of being straightforward and making these kind of connections, mm-hmm. and being, I don't know, the difficult craft of not being subtle in a way.
Oh yeah, I think you have a point here that in our in how we judge not only cinema but other art as well, to be subtle is many times considers very important or a value in itself, or not to be explicit, to be implicit, not to be very explicit. And although we all like and we all admire where something is, it's very, you know, just hints at something, you know, where there's this this subtlety in the expression, even if it's poetry or if it's painting, if it's film, whatever it is. But I also feel that, first of all, I am not able to be subtle in this way. I mean, I cannot be one of the filmmakers I used to admire a lot, and I still admire a lot, but less lately, is Ozu. And Ozu is a master of subtlety and the master of this nuance, of these details, of this... and you can take somebody like, to remain in the Japanese space, somebody like Nagisa Oshima's films, and all of a sudden this so-called Oriental Japanese subtlety, Zen quality disappears completely. And now I would say that I feel closer to somebody like Oshima in his films, you know. I'm keeping a distance to the work, not to the work of Ozu, which is great and I admire, but to this idea that a filmmaker needs to be subtle and not to be very explicit, because somehow I also have the feeling that, judging for the criticism I receive, that, you know, the people who would be offended by the films, this is why they want you to be subtle, in order not to offend anybody. You see, if you're subtle, if you're just poetical, if you're, you know, very implicit, and they praise you, you're being praised for being such a subtle filmmaker, but this doesn't affect anybody. So sometimes it's better, I think, not to be subtle. And I take it now not as a quality in itself, but I don't have a problem now for my lack of subtlety. For years I had this problem. I said, what the fuck? I cannot make a film like Ozu, you know, like a poetical. I want to be a poet in a way, to make a poetical work, and I'm not able to.
Well, but maybe there is some poetry to the lack of subtlety also. You're only a poet of the non-subtle. Like Oshima. Yeah,
but like the one you quoted at the beginning of our discussion. He wasn't very subtle as well. Yeah, well, actually, of course, it's a more complex thing. And if you read some of the Pasolini poems or some of Brecht's work, it's now subtle and it's great. And it is actually subtle, but in another way, I think. But it's complex. Is this the Romanian film critic Andrei Gorzo that said that regarding my films on a Facebook talk with somebody, who said, well, but being explicit doesn't mean the film is not complex. So the lack of being, I mean, to be explicit doesn't mean you lack complexity in the work. So I think that, yeah, maybe that's a good starting point. I don't know.
Well, And also in the question of subtlety, one thing that is often discussed, or something that made this discussion made me think about, was the showing of some things like dead bodies, for example, the showing of a cadaver, of a corpse. And I saw lately, I think I saw it yesterday or the day before, that you uploaded to La Loupe, you know, that international exchange film community, Stan Brakhage's The Act of Seeing with One Size. And this is a film that I find very hard to watch because...
Me too.
Yes, because it's you are facing...
an autopsy, yeah.
Yes. And I was thinking about the presence of dead bodies in your... When I saw that, I remember the presence of dead bodies in your films and the weight that it has, both in the exit of the trains and the marshals, two executions, and the...
Yes.
The shock that it brings to watch, to see the documentary footage of a person who is no longer living, and the difference between seeing someone, you know, the difference of whose dead body it is also, because this is, on the one side you have a victim, and then on the other side you have a perpetrator.
Yeah.
And then on the other side you also have a recreation of a death. So I wanted to ask you about that.
Yeah. Well, I uploaded that film of Brakhage on La Loupe because this is that was the first time I saw it. I know about it, but I never saw it until now. And I wanted the other two parts. It's a small trilogy in the work of Brakhage. And now, of course, the depiction of violence in any form in cinema and photograph and any form of representation is the one of the most unsolved problems of our practice. And I think it is unsolved because nobody found the solution, not even Susan Sontag in her famous work regarding the pain of others. In the end, you don't know, are you allowed to show, you're not allowed to show, is it good, is it bad, do the people get used to images of violence and then they will be not sensible to that, so it's not good to show. It's such an never-ending question, I think, and very, very important to answer all the time. And in the case of my film, I had to answer it, why to use that. Because, for instance, in the exit of the trains, which can be seen here, the last part of the film, which is 15 minutes or almost 20 minutes, I don't remember, it's with a montage of the photographs from the actual massacre of Yash from 1941, which was heavily documented, photographed, that the killing of those people, of Jews from Yash, was photographed, especially by German soldiers who were in town, and also by some secret service from the Romanian secret service, the agent. And my DOP, Marius Panduru, and he helped us with the correct technical things for this film, shooting the photographs and so on. At some point he said, look, man, but this is really, really disgusting to do that. Why do you want to, you know, this the moment of somebody who died, the cadaver, the corpse is intimate, it belongs to that person. Why do you need to show it? Would you like if somebody or if you will be killed or dead to put your body on a screen and a photograph with your body and people will look at it and then they will go to have a beer after a screening? And of course I said that no, but actually the reason we decided to have them, to have these photographs in the film, is the fact that it was a kind of small argument against the negationists. This event, the pogrom of Yash, the massacre in Yash, is not officially negated nowadays, but it's still negated by so many people, is still or downplayed. People say, well, it wasn't a big deal, come on, let's not exaggerate. So I said that, wow, with this, it works like a proof of the mass killing. So I said, and together with Adrian Cioflânca, because it's a film made with this historian, we said, well, I will take the guilt for using these images in order to have this. And the only solution I found is to keep the photographs not very much on the screen, so they do not become an object to contemplate. They are only a few seconds just to give the information, and then we pass to another one and to another one and so on. And this was my only answer I could have for that.
And what about the case of the marshals' two executions?
Oh, that's and also one more thing. I don't think I would use materials like that which are not already public. I wouldn't take the film if I would find it in an archive in some place hidden and put it on. I would think much more to that. For instance, the execution of Marshal Antonescu is also a document that is used in a lot of not only that it's gory and it was also made like a proof. I think the insistence on the corpses of Marshal Antonescu and his three colleagues being executed was to be a proof. For it wasn't shown publicly afterwards, but it was shown publicly immediately after the 1989 revolution in order to make a case for him, saying, look how they kill him like a dog, this great patriot, and so on and so forth. And then I didn't use this film, but only in juxtaposition with the way that the Romanian filmmaker, who was first of all the official filmmaker of the Ceaușescu regime, you know, Sergiu Nicolaescu, and then after the revolution he remained a nationalist with different forms. He wasn't a communist, but an anti-communist filmmaker all of a sudden, and even praising the fascist times of Romania and making this hagiography of Marshal Antonescu's personality, a film which is really, really a dirty film, and it's unbelievable that they are still showing it on television, or you can buy the DVD and so on. And he staged, he restaged that execution, of course, trying to make it in such a way as to be accurate to the document he had, but changing the details in order to create from this execution not a banal or, I don't know, a historical a reenactment of how the things happened, and because he had, of course, the documentary, but in order to, the details he left out and the details he added show very well the ideology at work in making a film. His film in this case, but any other film. So I think from this juxtaposition, or this clash of images, one can see and be, it's an invitation to be more reluctant to images like that, not to question them more, because now you see that when the man is shot, he falls down in 1 second, and in Nicolaescu's film he's waving the hat and falls down in 10 seconds, trying to be more spectacular. He creates a show, a nationalistical show in this way, a patriotical show. That's the idea. The creation of a myth. He tries to create a myth there out of that. That's the reason I show that.
Yeah, and also, well, there's this particular use of music, no? Very obvious use of music. And one thing that I also find very fascinating in this recreation.
Yeah,
thing.
True, absolutely, yes. Yes, a very...
Oh, and it's very, you know, it's corny, dramatic, but there's also this very, the moment that at the end of the scene, when after the death, is that he also shows the cameraman. So he shows the complete, the scene of the execution, including the documentation of the execution
exactly.
itself.
Yeah.
So as it seems like it's saying something like, you know, now in this recreation, we can even see what the archive cannot. which is the camarógrafo.
The cameraman, yes, it's true, it's true. Yeah, yeah, it's more complex like that, it's true.
It's very...
And it's very unusual for somebody like Nicolaescu, who took a lot of liberties. I think it's maybe the best scene he ever directed, because he's tried to make it so documentary-like. It's almost like as much as he could go to close to Robert Bresson in that scene. It's a Bressonian moment of Sergiu Nicolaescu. He's always otherwise beyond it's very, very exaggerated in everything. And here it's less than...
I wanted to ask you in regards to this, what is your... Well, so many of your films work with archives so precisely. In the case of Bad Luck Banging, it's a game of archive also, almost. Yeah. And I wanted to ask you, knowing that you are also part of this international film exchange communities, that we exchange films through them and talk about them, I wanted to know about your everyday relationship with archives, and where did you start, relating to archives in this way, in a way of creating films.
Oh, I'm afraid I cannot be very interesting here, because I don't have a particular relationship to that. I am interested, but only if it happens by accident to find something and then to follow this direction, or if I need something for an idea and then I start searching. But it's not, I'm not a buff, I'm not even a cinephile, like many people on La Loupe, for instance, who really have everything, and they place, many of them place everything at the same level. I don't place anything at the same level, or maybe I try to, but I am unable to do that. And of course, internet is a huge archive, but no, I don't. I'm not a buff into that. I'm not obsessed. I'm not searching just by. For the sake of searching, so to speak, until I get something. It's the other way around. If something starts to interest me, then I searching, and then if I encounter an archive or something like that, maybe I can use it. Or if it comes to me, for instance, now I will do another short film with photographs with Adrian Cioflâncă, and it's because he found an album of Romanian army on the Eastern Front. It's almost like souvenir photo album. I mean, they photograph the trees, the rivers, and not the massacres, of course, but sometimes the arrest of the Jews, this kind of stuff. So we decided to make this film because he found this album, and he didn't search particularly for that. He found it, and then he researched around it, and then we decided to make a short film out of that. So I think this is the way I do it. It's not a search, a big search for that.
I found very interesting what you said also earlier about that you would never use these images if they weren't public already. So, it made me think that, or the idea is that you would never use an archival material that is not part of public discourse already, in a way, because you seem to also examine a lot of how not only the image themselves, but how they circulated and where they circulated, for example, in uppercase print, television archives.
Yeah. Well, yes, but I think I mentioned specifically the image of violence in that case. I would be more reluctant to use it if I would find it. For instance, there is a film I found which is also about an execution, and from 1944, it is in the National Film Archives of Cinema, but I don't think I would ever use it, because it's not public. If somebody's making it public, maybe. So I'm speaking about this kind of images. Because other types of archives, of course, I think everything becomes an archive, everything becomes useful or can be used. And of course, we can have a lot of the ethical question remain in any case. It's like, you know, that like they always publish these private letters of writers or love letters of James Joyce or private letters of Emile Cioran, this kind of stuff, which of course our curiosity makes us read them, but you feel that it's a bit the people are dead and they cannot react, but still you feel, I mean, personally, I'm always split between that. I want to read it. I read Emile Cioran's letters to his lover when he was already quite old, with a lot of interest. But on the other hand, I feel that it's something that shouldn't be published. Of course, it's very private, and I don't have an answer. But still, we are publishing that, and we are watching that, and it's the same with. Porn materials. So whenever there's a headline like a film star, or I don't know, a star of any kind had some nude photographs on the internet, the first thing I do is to search for the photographs to see for real for myself. So it is a part of voyeurism in not only in cinema, but in cinema is already well known from the beginning of cinema, this relation, this difficult relation between cinema, the gaze, the voyeurism, and the line which is not very, very well fixed into that.
True. And I think also another interesting use of the archive in your work has to do with the off-screen space that the archive evocates in a way. So not only what the archive is showing, as you were saying before, I was thinking about showing, and you were saying I wouldn't show these images too long because I don't want them to be contemplated. But there is also, not in those particular images, but in the exit of the trains with all the images that we see of the people who were killed, there is always all this detail, or each picture has a different detail in them. I don't know, all the stamps, all the seals, all the things that we see around the pictures. And it's the same in Dead Nation, that these pictures not only show what they show, but they also evocate mental images of.
Yes. Yeah, because yes, actually, you put the film somehow together, and there's a lot of similarities between them because of the historical events they relate to, and because it's their films made with photographs, so it's like a kind of PowerPoint movies. We can call them PowerPoint films. And but I think they are very different because the Dead Nation, it was really born out of the research for another film. Mm-hmm. And these photos were scanned by Cesar Popescu, who discovered them forgotten in an attic in a small local museum and placed them online and scanned all of them. It's 9,000 of them. And all of a sudden they were mostly used in a kind of nostalgic way, so to speak. I mean, people were either coloring them, like it's now the fashion on the internet to make a color, any black and white image, or to say, oh, this is the land of our ancestors, this is how nice it was, or how. And for me, it was also because I was researching that period, and I said, well, it really is kind of weird. If only these images would remain, you wouldn't know that in the same time, a few kilometers away, or you know, in other, or on the Eastern Front, there were other things taking place, like the real ugliness of violence and these forgotten mass murders made by the Romanians, so by the Romanian authorities, army, not the citizens. So I wanted to place that. And to see what is, as you said, outside the frame. Of course, that was somehow a tricky thing. And if I would do the film again, I would insist, although it's obvious from the title, the second title, it's scenes from parallel lives, fragments of parallel lives. But still, some people say, oh, but you shouldn't place this with the photograph. So maybe I would be more careful that I would quote it at every sentence that I would say in the same time something was happening, although I would say it would be, it's quite obvious. But some people complained about that. And well, I would stop this by doing it like this. In the other film, in The Exit of the Trains, it's true that these are the remains. These are, I use this not only, and there the event that the text is related with the person in the photograph, it's a direct connection, so to speak. And I use that in order to give a face, because we always are speaking about abstractions, like 1,000 dead in this event, or 100 there, or 10,000 there in the case of Yash pogrom. But what does it mean, 10,000 of people? We don't know. We don't. So now, because of this huge research, which is not made by me but my co-director, by Adrian Cioflâncă, you have 200 and something of these faces. You have a representation of these people, and you, by seeing them one after another, and it's, I admit it might be a difficult watch, maybe you can have a representation of how many 10,000 mean, 10,000 people, is 10,000 people with faces, with their bodies, with their life, with their joys, with whatever a life is made of. And you say 10,000 and you say, well, it's just a number. And then you see 200 and you say, well, it's too much. I got bored in cinema for 3 hours or almost 3 hours seeing 200. And I would say, well, imagine how it would be to see 10,000. So maybe this is the idea, to give a bit of the insight of a suggestion of how huge it is, it was, how horribly huge.
Well, it's a way of orientation, in a way, not to try to really. It's the same as looking at faces, not to try to look at, and the details that in each description are very few details, but there's always like, this is how my husband, this is what happened to my husband or my son. Yeah. So in that few words, you understand, you know, that there's a family. You can picture, I mean, there are so many mental images that that I had from watching what each of these descriptions, and the same happens. I put them together because in The Dead Nation, there's also this idea of actual images and mental images. And I was reading a text by Patrick Holzapfel that said something like, watching The Dead Nation, I can't look at these images, because he's listening at the text. And then you have this, you know, you have the text also as an archive. You have this text almost as, it's not oral history because it's written, but it is an archival process also. That narration, the narration is what brings the mental images, whereas the actual images, it's true, they are harder to face.
It's absolutely true. And I think it's, you know, the playwright Eugen Ionesco always said that theater is superior to cinema because in theater there is space for imagination, while in cinema there is no space for imagination, because, well, in cinema you see everything, or the director, the filmmaker tries to make you see everything, so you don't really, the imagination is not used as much as in theater, where you see somebody on the stage and you have to imagine all the place and so on. And I think, well, I can see his point into that, since I read that, I said, well, I will always have at least some moments, or at least some films, where the imagination plays as big a role as in theater. So I think it's even more than in theater in this film, I guess. So I could say now, cinema is better because it can give you much more to imagine than theater.
I agree. And before we end, I want to give some space for audience questions. You know, everyone who's watching can ask a question and it will reach us. So there is one already that says, some of your recent films are considered to be inspired by Brechtian theory. Are there any Brechtian films, either in the history of film or contemporary cinema, that you find most influential and most interesting?
Well, now I don't know how to answer very properly, because I think it refers to the distanciation effect of from Brecht. And if that's the case, if that, because otherwise, you know, we know that Straub always considered John Ford to be the most Brechtian of filmmakers, and that is a little bit puzzling for many people to think of John Ford as a Brechtian filmmaker. So I would say Straub and Huillet, of course. I think it's a big influence, and also a big this kind of distance, this kind of mix of recitation, and the way they film is maybe something that we can call Brechtian. But I think the word, the concept is a bit too hazy for me to really understand what it is more than that. Because a distance, what can be, when I did Aferim, I did it black and white also to offer a kind of a distance. But then somebody, philosopher Christian Ferenc Flatz, wrote a text, and he said that on the contrary, that black and white of Aferim doesn't offer a distanciation, but a more immersive experience for the viewer. So I don't know. I'm not good at Brechtianism.
We have another audience question. Yes, I will read it for everyone. How did you choose TV excerpts that were used in uppercase print? Did you put them in random moment of the film, or you knew exactly where to put certain excerpts from TV programs? In other words, do you find either of them as a sort of comment to theatrical parts of the movie? How about the legal rights of those archives?
Okay, so it's a lot of
a lot of questions.
A lot of questions. Actually, in uppercase print, that's a good question. Did you put them in random moment of the film, or you knew exactly where to put it? The question. And I think one of the big thing in cinema and in the cinema talk, and actually in what filmmakers do, is to be, not to be random. Cinema is one of the things where precision and how should I say, the control is everything for most of us, I guess. So even if it's about dramaturgy and the dramaturgical construction, or if it is about the use of montage, or if it is about the use of an archive, whatever it is, people say, no, I had an exact reason for everything, and everything was controlled and nothing was left to chance. And on the contrary, I like to let more and more things to chance. And one of the things I did in uppercase print was that I had a criterion, which was the chronological one. So I used this archive images according to the chronology of the events, because on one side, for the people who haven't seen the film, you have the inquiry of a teenager from the Ceausescu's time, but by the Securitate, by the secret police. And it's a recitation of those files, like in a documentary theater, because the film is based on a documentary play, which is based on these files by Janina Cărbunariu. And then I used the... and this is joined together by this archive materials from the national television from the exact the same time. Sometimes the same day, sometimes one or 2 days before or after. It depends how I could found them and how they were existing. And but apart from this, I place them randomly, to be honest, most of the time, and see if they create something, or it's interesting, or rhythmically if it works or not. So yes, it was many times quite random, and of course. And of course, this is something that people would get away from it. Say, what do you mean random? I say, well, random. I mean, a painter can do random things, like throwing some paint on the canvas. Why not in film? And regarding the rights, well, the rights were from the national television, so we were okay with that. We didn't have we have a co-production with the television, so we didn't have a rights problem with that.
Thank you. And then one last question that from the audience, that is that you mentioned your next short film. Is there also a next feature film planned using archival material?
Well, actually, I would like to put together this a few short films, including the Marshall's Two Executions and some the ones I do now. There will be three or four, which all are using archives of different sorts. And I would like to put them together like in a film, maybe a 70, 80 minutes long, and to be called it exactly that, like a kind of almanac, a kind of attractions or film, like in the montage of attractions of Eisenstein, or like a volume of short stories. And I always ask myself why a writer can publish a volume with 10 separate stories, short stories, let's say, or a photographer can have an album with 20 or 100 photographs of different kinds, but as a filmmaker, you cannot have that. You cannot have. So I try to have my volume of short stories, so to speak, published with this film. Let's see if it will work. And I'm also in preparation, and I was a little bit late because I worked too much and didn't have time. I mentioned Christian Ferenc-Latz before, who's a philosopher, and he's also the translator of Walter Benjamin to Romanian and many other things, Husserl and so on. And he's interested in advertising, and together we have some money to make a film using advertising images from the last 30 years of capitalist Romania, so to speak. So yeah, we make an advertising film somehow, a film about advertising.
Wait, there is one more question, and I like it. So if we can have a few more minutes, I will ask you. Something that always surprises me of your cinema, Radu, is your ability to work across genres and film styles. What are you excited about experimenting with in your next film?
Yeah, well, I think it's very nice because now we are getting here. It's in our messages, because I think nobody's putting this question. So our colleagues are trying to save the day, and they are sending this question. So I think it's the moment where we are moving from documentary to fiction. So I think this is my answer. It's exactly this what I'm interested in, to move from documentary to fiction and back, and this move is what I found very interesting somehow.
Well, like the very concept of working with documentary plays, right? Your two of your latest works have been related to something that might be strange for some members of the audiences, which is the idea of a documentary play.
Yes, actually, you know, maybe it also has something to do with getting tired and bored and tired in a way about cinema, because Uppercase Print, of course, would have been done, you know, just take the story and then recreate it as a proper film. I mean, create the sets, shoot how the teenager goes and write the messages on the walls, and he's arrested, interrogated, and so on and so forth, and create a proper film, so to speak. And I precisely didn't want a proper film, a proper narrative film, because I'm getting tired to see this. I like it. I love a lot of films, but as a filmmaker, I don't know. I would say why not just take the text from the file as Gianina Carbonari did, and she put it together, and then we can shoot this, and from the text itself, this becomes the film, embodied by an actor or some teenagers in this case, And you don't need more than that. Of course, audience is rejecting that most of the time. They would say, well, this is not a film. We expect from our films to take it somewhere to show us, I don't know, a jungle or a light effect or a camera movement or some spectacular thing. I just saw Annette trailer, the Leo Carax new film, the trailer, and it's really, you know, spectacular. And you watch that and say, yeah, well, this is real cinema, not some some guys talking on the camera, saying some boring secret police file text. That's not cinema. Cinema is to be a show, to be a spectacle. And I'm too old already. Spectacle. No, but I mean it. When I did Aferim, that was really the biggest production I did. And it was really, for us, difficult to do it because, of course, we didn't have enough money. And it was, to go on the mountains or in the heat or in full of mosquitoes in the forest and shoot this. And then you say, why doing all that? Because I could do the same story in a set with wooden horses and with somebody, you know, so I would do it in this way now, I think.
I think, I mean, that speaks to there is something in your movies that you were talking about, the cinema of attractions, also, well, a montage of attractions, yeah. But also there's something of a cinema of attractions in your movies, which is, you know, this just the position of different materials and the idea that why do you need a real horse when you can have a wooden one? No, and that is also has to do with some,
yes,
I don't know, creating, yes, an illusion by other means. Yes. Showing the illusion, you know.
Yeah, you can make another film with Nicolas Zuckerfeld because you're mentioned there.
Yeah.
36 ways to ride a horse from. Right. So, yeah. The answer is you can use a wooden horse.
Yeah, exactly. There are no 36 ways of. Yeah.
The problem is solved.
Yeah, you can. You can make 36 wooden horses even.
Yes. Oh, yes, and then we go again.
So I think this is a good place to end. Thank you so much, Radu, for this conversation.
Thank you, Lucia.
And thank you, everyone who has been watching. And please remember that you can watch Radu's films until April the 30th in DAFilms. And well, we are all looking forward to the releases of your new film in all our different countries and also your new films.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much for everything. I don't know. I'm always embarrassed because I it doesn't matter. It's thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.